streaming today with no webcam. I got a new kitten and he found it fun to chew through a bunch of my computer wires. I just ordered one coming in the mail, but for today and tomorrow, bear with me, no webcam. But yeah, today I'm going to play a little more Legacy, and I've picked my old favorite deck, which is Elves. I'm going to run this through a 5-match Legacy League. I'm going to record it as a video for the ChannelFireball YouTube channel. So I do want to start by saying that this video is proudly brought to you by the new ChannelFireball Marketplace. With hundreds of local game stores on the marketplace, you can find all the sealed product and singles that you need while buying from stores that support our community. Check out channelfireball.com today and start shopping. And please do consider using my promo code Reid, R-E-I-D, to support me and the stream and my written content. Thanks also to Ultimate Guard. They're unveiling starting today the Ultimate Guard holiday giveaways. It's called the 12 Days of Ultimate Guard giveaway. So please do check out their website, Twitter account, online catalog for more information about Ultimate Guard's constant stream of awesome new products. Okay. Why don't I take this minute to go over some of the features of the deck list. A lot has not changed in all the years that Elves has been good. But a couple of things you might notice. One of Grist, the Hunger Tide. One of Endurance. These are cards that you can access via Green Sun Zenith. And having Grist allows you to build in answers to problematic creatures. Like, for example, an Aethersworn Canonist or something that's stopping you from comboing off. Here we go. Round one, Legacy Elves. This is a very good hand. It has a little bit of everything. Basic Swamp. Suspicious. Yesterday, I played Blue-Red Delver on stream, and my final match was a convincing loss against turn one, make you discard and then reanimate Grizzlebrand. That seems to happen an awful lot. Reanimator is historically one of the worst matchups for Elves because you have effectively no interaction in game one and they're just much, much faster than you. I actually do have the one Endurance, which, you know, every once in a blue moon you'll get lucky and just have that in your opening hand, but wouldn't have mattered in this case anyway since I'm getting unmasked on turn one. Okay, goodbye, Glimpse of Nature. Ah, I get a turn. Exceeding expectations. All right, Alright, so there's the Entomb. We already know they must have a reanimation spell since they exiled Animate Dead. So I think this is going to be a quick one. Can I beat Elish Norn? It would have to involve getting either Endurance or Craterhoof Behemoth on the battlefield and then sacrificing it via Grist. That's probably a pretty tall order. So I think I'm going to pack this one in. Pretty close, though. I got a 1-1 onto the battlefield. So I have 8 cards that I for sure want. Leyline and Thoughtseize. And then I have a bunch of sort of marginal options. Like, do you want to play the game where you're trying to kill the Grizzlebrand after it enters the battlefield? Do you want Collector Oof just to mess with Lotus Petal? Alcerous Shepherd is actually good against the Chancellor. Almost never sideboard out Glimpse of Nature, but if you're bringing in an awful lot of non-creature cards, it could be a consideration. So how many creatures does this leave me with? I mean, that's probably enough for Glimpse to still be a card that I'm happy to draw. Maybe not. Once upon a time. Yeah. All right, let's try this. All right, well, I was afraid this would happen, where I just have a really good hand on the play, but with no disruption, no endurance, no Thoughtseize, no Leyline. So I guess the question becomes, like, how likely am I to win on turn two? It's also possible after sideboard that my opponent could keep a hand that has a lot of discard spells, or they could keep a hand based on it having an answer to Leyline. So things can get a little bit bizarre after sideboarding. It's not always, the game doesn't always end on turn one or two. But let's think. Same to Once Upon a Time for, you know, Gaia's Cradle or something. It's pretty unlikely I'm going to be able to win on turn two. I could also Once Upon a Time and find Endurance. That's something that could happen. Sorry. Man, this is really close. I do have a lot of effective disruption, which makes it more reasonable to mulligan a hand like this. But I mean, this is a very, very good hand. It is difficult to think about mulliganing. Man. If I hit like Heritage Druid or Birch Lore Rangers off of Once Upon a Time, can this be a turn two kill? So tough. I think I'm gonna mulligan. Could be a fateful choice. Okay, this hand's much worse. Definitely mulliganing to 5 now, looking for Leyline, although if I could pick, I would definitely go back and keep that original hand. But hey, Leyline Thoughtseize. I I guess I'll bottom the second ley line in the forest. There's definitely some times when having two ley lines is effective if they're on wear and tear, but I've also had experiences where I start with two ley lines and they just play Serenity. And at five cards, I definitely need my resources. So I'm going to Thoughtseize and we'll find out both my prospects of winning this game and how effective that opening seven would have been if I had kept. Swamp, Lake of the Dead. Okay, so Lake of the Dead is their plan to fight through Ley Line. Looks like if I had kept, it would have been turn one, Thoughtseize me to slow me down, and then turn two, reanimate. So I probably would have lost, but my hand's looking much, much, much better now with the five cards. Notably, my opponent can reanimate or animate dead my creatures if they hit the graveyard, but I think it's pretty clear I should just take Thoughtseize and leave them with a bunch of useless stuff. Lake of the Dead could let them cast a, you know, say a Grave Titan at a certain point later in the game. Hard cast, Grief, who knows. Okay. So Zenith for one. Not anything super exciting I'm getting for one mana. So I suppose I'll save it. That's what I was gonna Zenith for anyway. Probably the single best draw step in my whole deck. Is 1-1 beatdown gonna do the trick here? All right, we'll get there. We'll get there. So they can actually generate 8 mana next turn, which is pretty scary. All right. Zenith. For Symbiote. So I guess I attack and then Zenith for Symbiote. Or I could just Zenith for another Visionary outright. Yeah, that's fine. I'll just Zenith for another Visionary.
Thank you.
Okay, do your worst. Scrappy game, but we got there. So seeing how that one played out, I'm actually happy to trim the fourth copy of Glimpse of Nature. I'm wondering if I should trim the fourth copy of Gaia's Cradle, just because these are going to be like kind of low resource games. But I think it's fine. Yikes. All the graveyard hate in the world, but no mana. Honestly, this is probably reasonable to keep. Yeah, I'm just going to keep it and hope I draw a land within my first, you know, three or four draw steps could still be good enough. Leyline of the Void against me. Interesting. That actually seems counterproductive unless they're on the Helm of Obedience plan. Strike one. And a hit. That's some technology. I don't think it's going to be that effective against me. It would have been if I continued bricking on lands, but what could I do? I could kill it with Grist. I think just playing the Visionary Symbiote combination is going to be really effective against that. Hey, Andrea. Having fun playing Legacy. Thanks for stopping by the stream. There's Helm of Obedience, so I may actually lose this game. Is there anything I can do? I guess I can try to combo off this turn. How likely is that? I did not bring in Craterhoof. I don't have any ways to destroy an artifact or enchantment in my deck right now. So I'm kind of just seeing this as either I win the game this turn or I lose. All right, so Zenith for Birchlore Rangers, play Nettle Sentinel, make mana. Bounce Birchlore, make mana. Or sorry, bounce Nettle, make mana. Play Visionary. I mean, maybe if I draw Gaia's Cradle, there's a chance here, but it's pretty thin. It's not looking good. Hey, we have a raid from the champion, Triosk. Yuki Ichikawa. Ichikawa, great job in the Innistrad Championship. I enjoyed watching. And thank you for the raid. Playing some Legacy today. So now I'm going to return Nettle Sentinel to untap Dryad Arbor. Oh, this is not going to work, actually. Yeah, this is bad. Well, let's see. If I untap Birchlore, if I return Birchlore, untap Dryad Arbor, then I can play Birchlore. I guess that's okay. Then I can get started. Yeah, I think I'm stuck. Well, that's a shame. I admit defeat. Pretty close, though. Okay, welcome back, match number two with Legacy Elves. I have a decent opening hand, but I'm on the draw again. Red Prison. Well, turn one Goblin Rabblemaster on the play is very scary. It's actually not the scariest thing that could have happened. We'll see. See if I can do anything about this. Need to get my feet underneath me somehow. Thanks for the question, Master Core. I'll try to address that in between matches. Eek! Bone Crusher Giant, okay. Well, let's try to block some goblin tokens. Hope I survive. Looking good, looking good. So three.
That's what I get for Christmas. You want a kitten? Well, then you're going to spend all the holidays alone.
Floating two. Six, floating five.
He has no keyboard or mouse.
Didn't even need the guy's cradle. Although I can now, if I want to, also activate Allosaurus Shepherd. So that's an attack for 27, and I actually could add 6 to it by activating Allosaurus Shepherd. I think this is generally a good matchup, although it is scary, can be scary. And I don't have a ton of sideboard cards. I'm going to bring in Assassin's Trophy at least. I might bring in Thoughtseize when on the play, but I don't think I need it on the draw.
He's really cute. And he's just ridiculous. And he's smart is really so good, and he just...
Yeah, let's keep it simple. Just do this.
He's just too much. He's just too much. Like, if you just chill out a little bit, like today they were fine. Like, he was, like, walking around her and, like, playing a little bit, and she's
Well, this hand could be functional under normal circumstances, but it doesn't really beat any turn one play that the red prison deck is gonna have. Like, it's not effective against Blood Moon, not effective against Magus of the Moon, not fast enough to race like a turn one Rabble Master. My opponent did mulligan ahead of me, so I mean there's some chance I could win with this, but I think my chances are higher by clicking the mulligan button. Hope no turn one Blood Moon, please. Hey, Soli Dan, thank you for the sub. I missed you a second ago. Good question from St. Nutritious. Do I expect a lot of Blood Moon effects in sideboard games? It's hard to tell. Definitely when my opponent is on the play, it's something I'm going to think about. It probably depends how many, you know, sideboard cards they have in there to bring in against me. It wouldn't be unreasonable to leave in some number of Blood Moon or Magus of the Moon in this matchup. But I'm honestly not sure. Well, unlike last game, it looks like the turn one goblin is going to be good enough. Like, if I just play Grist, I'm still dead on the board. So, Glimpse, Nettle, and then if I draw Birch Lore and have some crazy, crazy, crazy chain of events, maybe I can win.
Yeah.
I don't think it matters to keep the Dryad Arbor untapped, because I'm gonna need to use that mana to cast a spell to have a chance. Wicked Fridge says, I don't mind shaving some glimpses in this matchup. That's a reasonable suggestion, but I didn't really have a lot that I was excited to bring in from the sideboard. I might bring in like two Thought Seizes when I'm on the play, but I'm not excited about Thought Seize on the draw. That was pretty decisive. Good old red beat down. So my sideboarding last game was +2 trophy, -1 Craterhoof, -1 endurance. Now I'll also bring in 2 Thought Seizes. Don't think I like Fatal Push. If I had Progenitus in my sideboard, I'd probably keep like a couple of natural orders in Progenitus, but I'm not playing with that card in this league. Ooh, this hand is not great, but it is functional. The basic forest, if I was on the draw, I might keep on the strength of basic forest, but it's kind of like the Craterhoof Behemoth is not good to have in the opening hand, and this is just a pretty average configuration of 6 cards, so might try to throw it back. Prometheus writes, that's about the worst possible reasonable keep. I agree, it's very marginal. It's close to the borderline, but I think I can do better. Yeah, so there's the turn 1 Thought Seize. Let's give it a try. So I'm gonna keep and ship the Gaia's Cradle. So far we're, 6 games in, and this league has been remarkable in how many, like, interesting mulligan decisions I've faced. So we have turn 1 Chalice, but I do have the Allosaurus Shepherd. This Fiery Confluence card's actually very, very scary. So if my opponent goes Ancient Tomb Chalice, then I go like Shepherd Wirewood Symbiote. That's probably a fine outcome. So then I'll take the Fiery Confluence. Let's see. Yeah, sure.
All right. Thank you, Laura. Nice talking, though.
Clark writes, does Elves have any good matchup at all currently? I think that question indicates that we're definitely coming from different positions when it comes to the Elves deck. I think the better question is, like, does Elves have bad matchups? the matchup that I'm playing, for example, I think is significantly favorable. Not like you can't lose, but I would for sure rather be on the elf side. This. Yep. So things are looking kind of bad if you just look at the battlefield, because, you know, now my Alistar Shepherd is dead and I'm underneath the chalice. But keep in mind, every play my opponent makes, they're taking 2 damage. So I can definitely just nickel and dime them out between the Ancient Tomb and some little elf beatdown. Thanks, Jackie Brown MTG. That's a nice thing to say to someone. All right, so what am I going to do here? I'm probably going to cast Glimpse of Nature to untap Nettle Sentinel. And then do I continue attacking? Do I start holding back? So the options are like Glimpse, attack with both. Glimpse, attack with just Nettle Sentinel. Or Glimpse and leave Nettle Sentinel back to block. I think I like Glimpse and attack with just Nettle Sentinel. That's a no block. So now they really can't tap the Ancient Tomb anymore. Have I written anything about alchemy? I did. I wrote an article outlining my thoughts on the alchemy format. It's on Channel Fireball. All right, I I think I'm dead. I needed this a couple of turns ago. It's just barely too late. I mean, what can I do? Zenith for Shepherd or Visionary, pretty much. Yep. Tough day at the office. I keep losing these narrow, scrappy game threes. All right. So Masticore writes, in your feature match against Sam Pardee during the Innistrad Championship, you played Thoughtseize, Sam countered it, and before attacks killed your Dreadhorde Arcanist. You then attacked for one, played a land, and Kroxa, Sam discarded Shark Typhoon. I, Masticore, think it was crucial to not let you play Kroxa. I see two lines. First, cycle Shark Typhoon for three. Thus, if you want a Thoughtseize again, you are one card further from playing Kroxa. Second, draw two new cards with Charm and not kill Arcanist. Well, I would say that Sam's thinking was probably that he needed me to not have an untapped black source to be able to return the Kroxa that turn. However, I do agree with you that I think Sam should have been employing the draw two cards mode with Archmage's Charm a little bit more often than he was. I thought that was an interesting game, and thanks for the good question. Yep, that's the kitten. He woke up. You've noticed a downtrend in green-black Yawgmoth decks in Modern. I guess I haven't really noticed the same thing. I think it's really hard to tell. Like, there's so many different decks in Modern that could just be, you know, an anecdotal thing that you haven't played against it in a number of matches. But it's hard to actually know the statistics. Okay, let's get back to some Elves matches. Who is my favorite non-American MTG player? Well, I guess my favorite player to root for who's not an American would probably be Kai. But the question has become, like, that question has become a little bit stranger as I've, like, gotten to know a lot of these players, and they're, like, my friends. But, yeah, I would say growing up watching the Pro Tour before I met people in person, I always liked rooting for Kai and Nassif. I'm not going to weigh in on the ban control question. I haven't played that strategy yet. Maybe soon, though. What's the best way to attain signed cards from players and artists? I really like getting my cards signed by players and artists, and usually just when you go to the big convention, there's an opportunity to meet those people and ask them for their autograph. I've owned a cube at a couple points in my life. I don't have one built right now, but there was one time when I built the Magic Online cube because I wanted to practice for an event that was using the Magic Online cube, and I didn't want to be limited to only the 1 week that it was available on Magic Online. And then there was also a time when my brother and I just built our own cube of all our favorite cards, and that was really cool too. Yeah, I would generally agree with Rain. I think it's, you have, for me, you kind of have to have a special reason to not play with red in Legacy because of how strong Pyroblast is. Hey, we got a big raid from Raphael Levy. Another one of my favorite non-American players, Raphael Levy. Raph, thanks for the raid, buddy, and welcome to everybody who's coming from Raph's channel. Playing some Legacy today. This is my third match with Legacy Elves, and I have lost all my die rolls, which is pretty bad when you're playing Elves, but this at least is a pretty decent opening hand. Right before Raph showed up, people were asking what non-American players do I root for in tournaments, and did I used to cheer for when I was growing up watching the Pro Tour. Raph is one of the first pros that I played against. Grand Prix Montreal sealed deck 2010, 2011, probably 2011. Well, more Reanimator. Raph says, oh, I remember that. Did you have Wrath of God and Sarah Angel in your deck? I did. In fact, I think I might have had two Sarah Angels. My deck was really, really good in that event. So notably, my opponent faithlessly looting into Chancellor of the Annex, but they did not reveal Chancellor. So they might have had to keep a hand with no creature or something along those lines. At any rate, we're starting with Once Upon a Time. Yeah, might just try to ramp my mana and hope I draw into something or be on the Alice or a Shepherd plan. Shepherd is notably really good against the Chancellor's ability. Unmask, targeting me.
Thank you.
Glenn asks, well, might as well take some Q&A while I'm, you know, letting my opponent solitaire over there. But Glenn asks, do you watch other stream or content creators? Yeah, I read a lot of written Magic content. That's the I guess, medium that I consume the most is written Magic content. But I also watch streams. I watch a lot of Yellow Hat stream. In terms of other games, I've been watching the Chess World Championship recently. Yeah, I like to dart around and experience some other cool stuff. All right, I think that's it for me. So I've been honing my anti-reanimator sideboard plan, and I think I basically just want to be prepared to play like a low resource style of game, which means trimming some of my combo type stuff. Don't worry, everybody. Losing game one against Reanimator is very much part of the plan. Yep. It's a functional hand with Leyline. I wish this was a Bayou or a fetch land, but so be it. Okay, my opponent is mulligan to five, so hopefully I'm just gonna win this one on Leyline. Yeah, stuff like Run Afoul, Assassin's Trophy, Grist. Those are cards that can be useful when the game plays out a certain way. But you have to make some tough choices because you have a lot of cards to board in. Elves is also very much a critical mass deck, so the more non-elf cards you sideboard in, the worse your deck functions. Probably wait one turn on glimpsing. So I could either Thoughtseize or I could start a glimpse turn. I'll Thoughtseize and then try to glimpse next turn.
Yeah.
Echoing Truth. Wow. So get the Arbor, tap the Cradle for 3. Should probably attack for 1 first. Yeah, let me undo this. Attack for 1 and then continue comboing after combat. Here's 5 mana. We're gonna morph a creature. Gonna make black. Untap Dryad Arbor. Make another black mana. Play a backup ley line. Okay, game 3. Let's see if I can get on the board with an actual match win here. Right, high power legacy in action. Some scrappy games. I have played with Elvish Reclaimer, yes. I think it improves your matchup against Merit Lage decks, but I generally like the more streamlined version better. All right, 2 7 card hands with Leyline. You love to see it. So I think I want to go for Bayou and then cast Once Upon a Time. Ooh, Endurance. That's good backup. It's Endurance or Elvish Visionary, right? Probably I should take Endurance. I mean, the worst thing that could happen is I just play it as a 3/4 beatdown creature. Mm-hmm. Alright. I suppose I'll see what I can do. Chat is correct that if you expect to face Reanimator in 2/3 of your matches, you would not choose Elves. The problem is that you just almost always lose game one. Like, you only win game one if they mulligan to like 3 or below. And I don't think that sideboard games are that bad with my current configuration, but it's just easy enough for them to steal one of the two sideboard games. And that's how both of these matches have gone, right? Where it's like, they win game one, I win game two, and then they kind of are able to assemble their Hail Mary anti-graveyard hate sideboard plan. You know, in the last match it was Leyline Helm, in this match it was Show and Tell Grizzlebrand. Don't Daze Me writes, if you're expecting Reanimator, would some number of scavenging ooze be worthwhile? Maybe even one in the main for game ones. I mean, that's a card that I would definitely have in my deck if I had access to it, but the problem is that Reanimator is just so fast. They reanimate on turn one. Like, the games where you get access to 4 mana are not the games that are the problem. I think Endurance is the card that you want. If your goal is to try to win game one. What would you play if you knew in advance it was a heavy Reanimator metagame? I mean, probably just a blue deck with a bunch of Surgical Extractions in the sideboard. I don't think you really need to choose a special archetype to beat Reanimator. Just having a reasonable deck plus a bunch of Graveyard Hate is probably puts you in a good spot. I like Death and Taxes. Yeah, maybe I'll try to play that at some point. Thank you. Alright, so I need to find Grist, basically. Grist or Zenith to get that Sarah's Emissary off the battlefield. Huh. So I can get 5-6 mana. I don't think there's any way to get to 8. Doesn't matter anyway against the Sarah's Emissary. Yeah, I think I just lose. Okay, GG. Does Fairy Macabre see sideboard play anywhere for Graveyard Hate? I would definitely say Surgical Extraction is more popular. Fairy Macabre has some weird uses, like for example, if you were playing... This is more applicable to Modern than Legacy, but if you were playing a Cascade deck that had like Shardless Agent and you didn't want to have to actually cast your Graveyard Hate card, then Fairy Macabre could be an option. Hey Luis, it was nice to meet you in Vegas, and it was a pleasure to sign your thoughtsies. I've had folks asking me in chat what cards do I often sign. Definitely signed a lot of thoughtsies and Tarmogoyfs in Las Vegas. I've signed a lot of Slippery Boggles in my day. Which one would I choose to sign? Well, it's not about what I want. It's about what would make you happy. What card do you want to own as a signed version? Have I signed any Urza lands? I'm sure I have, yeah, but that's not one of the common ones. Goat Hulu, thank you for the sub. Goat Hulu would choose Reid the Bones. I like it. Welcome back to match number 4 with Legacy Elves. Still looking to get on the board, but I get to be on the play this time. Do I ever have my cards signed by players? Yeah, I have tons of cards signed by players. Wow, is this going to be another Reanimator player? Yep, it sure is. Come to twitch.tv/readerrabbit where you get to watch Reid lose on turn 1 repeatedly. I'll play a 1-1. Oh, you draw 14 cards and kill me? Sounds great. I mean, I said you can win game one if they... I said I could win game one if they mulligan to three. This player's mulligan to five. Is it enough? Will it be enough? Would I try Doomsday? Of course. I really enjoy playing combo decks. I've played Doomsday in Vintage a little bit. I'm actually just going to search for... Oh, actually, let me rethink this. I was going to say I'm going to search for a Dryad Arbor, but I might need access to a Bayou. So yeah, cancel out of order. I'm going to play Elvish Visionary off of Bayou this turn. All right. So I could just put Grist onto the battlefield. What else could I do? Once Upon a Time and hope to hit Heritage Druid.
Why?
Or.
Okay. Well, I'll give you some insights.
I guess. Yeah, I think Once Upon a Time is actually a good play here. And I did hit Heritage Druid. Very good. So reset the Bayou. Make some mana. And vomit my hand onto the table. That's what I got. Alright, I won a game. I won game one against Reanimator. Maybe should I start bringing in one Assassin's Trophy for this matchup? So I was trimming the fourth glimpse, and then what else? I could trim the fourth cradle, I could trim one more one mana elf, I could trim a symbiote. It's kind of counterintuitive, because in game number one, the symbiote visionary thing is really slow against the combo deck, but after sideboarding, when both players are bringing in like eight or more cards, the games get really scrappy and they turn into low resource battles where the symbiote visionary thing is actually quite good. So I don't think I would cut a visionary, but for my last cut, I could not bring in the Assassin's Trophy. I could cut a symbiote. I could cut another one mana elf. I could cut another glimpse. I could cut a Gaia's Cradle. Yeah, we've talked about basically every card in the 75 has an argument in this matchup, but you just have to make some tough decisions. I do like having the Grist in the deck over like Run Afoul or Seconds Assassin's Trophy, because it's more proactive and you can find it with Green Sun Zenith.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Shepherd is really good against Chancellor of the Annex. All right, I'm going to cut the fourth symbiote. Try that. Well, this is a slow hand on the draw with no ley line. So if I'm consistent with my previous strategy, I'm going to mulligan this hand. And there we go. There's ley line. So keeping this and shipping, I'd say, the Yavimaya. All right, bad matchup, come on. That was a no contest in my favor.
No, that's it, I gotta go. Email it to me though. And I don't know if you have another time to speak for something in the morning.
Welcome back to the fifth and final match with Legacy Elves. Hasn't been a super successful league, but I would still really appreciate ending on a high note. I'm up against a Yorian deck, so a fair matchup for once. And okay, this is going to be a pretty good six-card hand. The question is just what to put on the bottom. Looks like I want to turn one Zenith for Arbor, and then turn two... could just cash in Glimpse of Nature for, like, draw three cards. So bottoming maybe Bayou. So if this turns out to be Death and Taxes, then we'll have seen the two extremes of the Elf deck, like the worst matchup in Reanimator or the... you know, the classically worst matchup is Reanimator and the classically best matchup is Death and Taxes. But this is not Death and Taxes. This is going to be probably the Green Sun Zenith 80 card Yorian deck. So yeah, definitely don't mind like Glimpse, Symbiote, Shepherd, Bounce Shepherd, Replay Shepherd, draw three. Alternatively, I could just play like Visionary. I could just play out some creatures, but I like this. And if this ends up earning Force of Will, then that's good for me too. So yeah, just good solid, one green mana, draw three cards. The green Ancestral Recall. Abundant Growth. Abundant Growth makes its Legacy debut. Yep. One quality that I do really like about elves is that it's good at beating Uro. Like, not that Uro's a bad card, but just when you get to combo off, you don't really care about your opponent getting a little bit extra life or a little bit extra value. My draw has stagnated a little bit since that Glimpse of Nature turn. But my opponent doesn't seem to be doing a whole ton either. Okay. Good question from Abel. Why not fetch before drawing in this instance? Because there could be a sequence that involves drawing Gaia's Cradle. I guess at face value, if I had drawn Gaia's Cradle, then I could attack and use Allosaurus Shepherd's ability. But yeah, you often, like, there are reasons to deviate from this, but the default with elves is to wait as long as possible to make your land drop each turn, because you kind of never know when you're going to want to get Gaia's Cradle, when you're going to want to get Dryad Arbor. Okay, that's the last fetchable land in my deck. Okay, so what happens if I Zenith for Heritage Druid? So I tap three mana, I get a Heritage Druid and Nettle Sentinel, then I tap them in the Visionary, I make three mana, bounce Visionary, untap Dryad Arbor, recast Visionary down to one, tap my three elves up to four, 5/6 for my lands. Looks like not quite enough to cast Craterhoof. It's possible I miscounted, but I think I'm more likely gonna wanna just Zenith for another symbiote. Gaia's Cradle. Now that definitely changes the equation. Now I probably want a Zenith for Heritage Druid. Or does it even matter? Yeah. Zenith for Heritage Druid. Well, wait. Let's see. Okay. I generally like playing this kind of matchup because you can see how just playing a couple of creatures and a couple of removal spells is usually not good enough against the elves. They really need to have like a board sweeper or a plague engineer, something kind of special like that in order to shut you down. Yeah, this hand's fine. Have Reid and Jim Davis done Legacy Elves versus Goblins? I played against Jim in that matchup actually many times on the SCG tour, but there's a really good one. I think it's semifinals of SCG Philadelphia. Jim Davis versus Reid Duke in Goblins versus Elves. Okay. I think I should probably take Quirion Ranger. Why did I board out Endurance against a deck with Uro? Well, as mentioned, Uro is not really a key card in this matchup. Like, they can win the game with Uro, but only after they've done a lot to dismantle my combo in the first place. So I'd rather just focus on that battle of comboing off and having Thoughtseize in case they have Plague Engineer. Ooh, Birchlore Ranger is very interesting draw. So, how do I want to do this? Birchlore. Quirion. So I wanna kind of go for it here. But the question is, at what point do I want to sneak in a glimpse, and do I want to play two glimpses? I guess we'll go for it as early as possible. Well, as early as possible would be right now, I guess. I think I'm going to play Birchlore. So let that resolve. Then Cradle Glimpse. And it's not impossible to get a turn two kill here. But at worst, I'm just going to set up to have a nice turn next turn. Yeah, I think I'm just going to go for the good clean win here. So here's second glimpse, Heritage, Quirion untaps itself. And we're off to the races. All right. Now that was a good clean win. It was definitely a rocky start to that league, but that final match I think showed the power of elves and the type of matchup you want to play and the types of games that do go in your favor. That was actually a turn two win, so very nice.